In this lecture, we shall be talking about the universal serial bus or the USB, which has become a real kind of an universal bus standard today. So, almost all the devices that you want to connect to the computer system, we will see that there is a USB interface available. So, you compare this scenario with the computer systems that are available about, let us say, 15-20 years back. So, there you would see there will be so many different kinds of different connectors at the backplane of your PC. The keyboard will be connected using a special kind of a connector, mouse will be connected using another kind of a connector, then the serial port, there will be RS-232 serial port connector, the printer will be connected to a printer connector, network will be connected to a different kind of a connector. So, there will be a host lot of connectors, but this USB tried to means integrate or consolidated all these bus standards into a single bus standard, come up with a standard which is acceptable to means almost all different kinds of application, so that you can have a computer system with, let us say, a single kind of a port. There are no, you see, if you look at a very modern laptop today, you will see that it has only USB ports, nothing else. So, everything else you want to connect, you have to connect through USB only. That is what is happening today. Okay. So, the topic of today's lecture is universal serial bus or USB. So, as I said, USB is the most popular bus standard. External bus standard means it is not used inside a computer system, but rather this is used to connect some device to the peripheral system external to the system, okay, outside the computer. So, today this USB standard allows connection of almost all types of devices. So, devices can include keyboard, mouse, printer, scanner. Well, our mobile phones also have a USB interface, disk, pen drive, camera, anything you name, you will find that there is an USB interface available. Now, the advantage of USB is that it facilitates high speed transfer of data. Now, this standard has evolved over the years. Some of the standards I am showing, version 1.1, 2.0, 3.0 and 3.1, and these are the years where they were proposed. So, the first USB 1.1 version, it worked up to a speed of 12 megabits per second. So, at that time it was considered to be good enough. But USB 2.0, which came in 2000, the speed was jacked up to 480 megabits per second. But this 3.0 and 3.1, they have brought it to an altogether different level, 5 and 10 gigabits per second. So, with the modern day USB interface, you can interface virtually any kind of device, because 10 gigabits per second is really fast. There are newer standards available which can go even higher, 40 Gbps also. But so, whatever kind of device you can think of, you will normally not be exceeding this limit. So, you can use it for almost all kinds of applications, right? Fine. Now, talking about the history, well, this was a standard which was jointly formulated by 7 companies, which included Compaq, Digital Equipment Corporation, which of course today is no longer there. Compaq is also no longer there. This IBM, Intel, Microsoft, NEC and Nortel. So, they sat down together and felt that there is a need or necessity to come up with a new standard for connecting peripheral devices. The main goals were twofold. First was, there was a big problem, as I said, that connecting external devices to the computer. Earlier, there are so many different standards. That is why the computer systems came up with so many different sets of connectors. So, depending on the device, you would be connecting them to one of the available connectors. The audio system, it had a separate connector and so on. This was one of the things. So instead of having so many different kinds of a connector, why not have a single kind of a connector that can connect almost all devices? And the second problem is also important, to simplify software configuration of the devices you are connecting. Now with USB, there is a mechanism, if you connect a device through the USB port, the system software will automatically try to find out what kind of device it is, and it will automatically try to locate and install the device driver. So this you might have experienced when you connect various devices like pen drives and other devices to a computer system, but earlier it was not like that. So when you connect a new device, you will have to put in a CD or a DVD containing the device driver, and you will have to manually install the device driver, then only the device will work. Okay? So this USB also made this task easier. So as I said, the first USB version 1.0, this appeared as early as in 1996. There are many other versions in between. The latest version is 3.1. Now let us look a little bit inside USB, how it works. First is that it is a serial bus standard. Data are transmitted serially, and they uses differential NRZI encoding. Well, let me first tell you what is meant by differential. Well, when you carry out communication, suppose I have a sender. There are two ways in which you can send data. You can have two wires. So, one wire can carry your signal and the other wire can be ground. So, when you connect this signal to the receiver should also know that this is your signal and this is your ground. So, you have to connect the signal in the proper order. This is sometimes called single ended connection. There is an alternate way of connecting. Here what I am saying is that we do not have a separate ground connection, rather signal is sent over two lines, one we call it as V plus, one we call it as V minus, and the receiver receives these two signals. So, the idea is that the signal that is transmitted is actually represented by the difference of V plus and V minus, and modulus of that, either V plus can be higher, V minus can be higher, or the reverse. And this mode of transmission is called differential mode of transmission. The advantage of differential mode of transmission is that, suppose when there is a communication link like this, there can be some nearby sources of noise like power supply lines and other things, which will be injecting noise on the communication lines. Now, if it is a pair of wires, the same noise will be injected on both the lines, and if you subtract them, the noise will be cancelled out. So, at the receiving end, you will be having some kind of a differential amplifier, so which will be finding the difference of the signals, amplify it and feed it to the receiver. But on the single ended case, since one line was grounded, grounded line is never impacted by noise. Noise will only affect the line carrying the signal. So, the receiving signal would be degrading in quality. So, differential signal has this one advantage. Okay. So, the way the data bits are encoded, there is a standard way, non-return to zero immediate NRZI it is called, this NRZI encoding is used. Well, in NRZI what is done is that, so depending on the bit you are sending and the previous state of the line, you do not send the bit 00 or 11 directly, depending on what was in the previous state. Suppose if the bit is 0, the earlier the line was 0, then you send a 1. Well, if the bit is 0, earlier the line was 1, you send 0. If 1 0 0 1 1 1. Let us take an example and see what happens. Suppose my data that I am transmitting is 0 0 0 0 1 1 1 1. And let us say my line was initially, the line was at, let us say 1. So, let us see what will happen here. Okay. So, the previous state was 1, now the line is 0. So, you look at this table, previous line state is 1, bit to be sent is 0. So, new line state will be 0. So, new line state 0, bit to be sent is 0, we make it 1. 1, new line state, previous state is 0, make it 0. So, in this way it will be 1, and 1 and 1 it will remain 1, 1 and 1 and 1 again, previous line state is 1, this 1, like this. So, you do a kind of encoding before you are actually sending the data, right. This is called NRZI encoding. So, NRZI encoding has some good properties that you always inject some transition 0101. Well, even if your line is continuously at 0, the input is 0, mean a long stream of 0, but still in the line there will be some transitions. Now, transitions on a line is always good because you can synchronize the receiver. If the signal is changing, receiver can synchronize itself with the transitions. So, it is always desirable in a serial communication link that there should be sufficient number of transitions on the line. Okay. Now, there is another way to ensure that long streams of zeros and ones will never be there. There is a method called bit stuffing, which is also used in USB. Bit stuffing says that whenever there is a sequence of 6 consecutive ones, then the transmitter will forcibly insert a 0. So, let us say this is the bit stream to be communicated. Here you see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 ones are there consecutive. So, after 6 ones, a 0 is getting inserted and this stream is transmitted. So, the receiver will again receive the same thing. Whenever it will receive 6 consecutive ones, it will drop the next bit. The advantage of bit stuffing is that you will never have a scenario where the line will be having continuous stream of long stream of ones. This NRZI, this ensures that zeros will be not be there, long stream of zeros, and bit stuffing will ensure that long stream of ones will not be there. So, there will be guaranteed transitions on the lines. Okay. This is ensured by these two methods. Right. Now, another interesting thing is about USB connectors. You have seen USB connectors yourself because you must have handled all these devices. Well, traditionally this USB connectors came in two kinds of connectors, type A plug and type B plug. Type A plug has an elongated cross section, which inserts into a type A receptacle. Receptacle means a type A plug can go inside a type A receptacle only. So, there will be like a male-female connector, it is called. A connector will be going inside another connector. A type A can go inside a type A only. But the two connectors are different. The type A USB connector and the type A receptacle connectors are different. The type A connector will go inside the type the receptacle. Normally, when you say a computer system or a laptop, the connectors which are available, those are the receptacle connectors. And a device when you connect, that is your normal type A connector which goes inside that receptacle, right. This is what is. And the type B plug looks different. So, it is not elongated and flat, it looks like a square with the top external corners beveled. Beveled means it has a shape like this, a shape like this, right. square where the top two corners are a little curved. Now, this type B plug traditionally was used to insert into an upstream port or a device that is a printer. Let us say earlier when you used to connect a printer or a plotter to a computer system, you have a USB cable where on one side you had a type A plug, on the other on the other side you had a type B plug. The type B plug will go inside the printer, type A plug will go inside the computer system. So, it means with the developments in the standards and this USB versions, nowadays this difference is no longer required. So, you can have a cable with the same kind of connector at both ends. So, you can connect the cable in any order you want. Okay. It is not that type B will go into the printer and type A will go into the computer and not the reverse, not like that. Okay. So, there have been developments where we are now having smaller devices like your laptops and tablets and mobile phones, digital cameras. So, it was felt that the type A and type B plugs are too large. So, there were smaller versions of USB connectors that came up, the mini USB and the micro USB connectors. So, I am just showing you some pictures here. This picture shows you the type A connector. You see, the type A connector is the one which you see mostly. It is a little elongated and flat. This is your normal connector and this is your receptacle. The normal connector will go inside your receptacle. And type B looks like this. This will be your type B connector and it will go inside a receptacle that looks like this. Say for example, if you have a printer with a type B connector. So, on the printer you will be having a port like this and on the cable you will be having a port like this, right. And this standard USB connector looks like this and the corresponding mini connector looks like this. So, you see it is less than half the size. Micro USB connector width wise it is almost same, but thickness wise it is smaller. Now, you see the connector which you have on our mobile phones today, let us say the connector which you have in the back, this one, this is an example of a micro USB connector. So, the cable that you connect to it, that is a micro USB cable, right. Okay. So, in USB, there is a concept of a bus hierarchy, the way the USB devices are connected. Now, let us look at this picture. So, on the top part, we have a host computer. This can be a PC, a desktop or a laptop. So, you have your system bus. Well, here I am not showing the north bridge and south bridge separately. I am just showing it in an abstract sense. There is a CPU, there is a memory, you have a CPU bus, you have a memory bus. Maybe your north bridge is sitting here. Then you have a system bus. Maybe this is your south bridge. This is connected to a chipset which is your USB host hub. So, USB host hub, this chipset is available, that also is inside your computer motherboard. So, this from the USB host hub, you have all the USB connectors on your computer. An external device, you may be having a pen drive or any other device, you want to connect it to the USB host hub. So, you have the connectors here that will be connecting to one of the host computer connector. So, the two buses that you have here, system bus and USB host hub, they are connected through the so called USB internal bus and interface. And when you connect an external device through an external cable, that is referred to as USB external bus and interface. Now, bus topology, well, by bus topology what I mean is that how this external devices are connected. See, just inside the computer system it is fixed. Now, how we can expand the capability after that? You can connect several devices outside. Now, also you have you must have seen there are some products called USB extenders available. So, you plug a device to the USB port, on the other side you will be getting 4 USB ports, okay. This kind of devices are also available. So, you have a USB connection topology that is sometimes called a bus topology. I will be illustrating with the example. So, this bus topology is used to connect the computer system, which is sometimes called the host, to the peripheral devices. Now, again you think of the master slave relationship I talked about earlier. When say you connect a computer with a peripheral device like a pen drive, your computer works as the master and your pen drive works as the slave. Well, a few years back, when you connect a mobile phone to your laptop, your mobile phone also can be used only in the slave mode. But nowadays, with the advancements in the operating system and the hardware of the mobile phone, for example, this is a modern mobile phone. Here, you can use this mobile phone as the master as well. Like here, you have a micro USB connector, you can connect an adapter. Through that adapter, you can connect a pen drive to this mobile phone also. There, this mobile phone will be acting as the master and that pen drive will be acting as the slave, right. So, this bus topology is typically a star topology, tier. It is a multi-tier architecture, not a single level. There can be multi-level of hierarchy and it looks like a star. There is no loop or feedback. We will take an example. So, the devices are all connected to a common point, which actually is called the root hub, that refers to the master. And in this star topology, the USB specification is such that you can connect up to 127 devices, and each USB connection is a 4-wire cable, just a power supply, a ground and 2 differential signaling lines V plus V minus, as I said. Now, with the development in the USB technology, the power and the ground lines are also such that sufficient power can be delivered over the lines. Like you must have seen today, nowadays the external hard disk drives that are available, you can straight away connect them to the USB port without any need to separately connect any power supply. Now, you recall in an external hard disk, there has to be some motors inside. The platters will be rotating, so there will be significant power requirement there. So, that entire power can be drawn from the USB power lines. Okay. And the lastly, as I said, so USB is called a polled bus, like all transactions are initiated by the host, that is the root. So, the bus topology, this tiered architecture looks something like this. So, you have a host root hub, this is your host connection. You can connect this D circular things are the devices, these are your USB devices. So, if you want, you can connect a device directly through a hub. Now, if you want to extend the capability, you can connect several levels of hubs. And there are hubs which can be having several different connections. Say, suppose this hub has 4 connections, you can connect 4 devices. This hub has 4 connections, you can connect 4 devices. So, like this, you can develop a tree or a star kind of a connection with which you can connect up to 127 USB devices. Now, see here you have host, your hub, you have the devices. So, talking about the host, it is a device that controls the entire system, and this host is usually a computer or a laptop, and in my example I took. So, some mobile phones can also act as the host. So, it will be processing data arriving to and from the USB port, and it contains, well, in the host there are a sophisticated set of software drivers. So, depending on the kind of USB devices that are connected, the appropriate drivers are selected and they are executed, so that data transfer takes place. So, because of this kind of an operation, this USB is not so easy to use in small standalone systems where there is no operating system support. So, you need a OS support, you need to install the driver software, then only you can use USB in a proper way. So, the interface to the USB root hub is sometimes called the USB host controller. Talking of the USB hub, well, USB hub checks for new devices that you are connecting to it and maintains status information. Like when you connect a new device to an USB port, that port will check what kind of device it is, and depending on that, it will try to locate the driver that needs to be activated. If the driver is not available, the host will try to install that new driver. Okay. So, the USB hub also acts as a repeater, like it can boost signal strength for both way connections upstream and downstream. Not only that, it serves the purpose of electrically isolating devices from one another, and this allows you to expand to a larger number of devices. You can remove a device if you want which is not working properly. So, you can have any kind of connection because of those hubs. So you can have several hubs, and a hub will be isolating the devices that are under it from the rest of the system, just like a network switch or a network hub you use for connecting computer system. The same concept is used here, and these USB hubs are available as separate systems which you can purchase and connect to your system to expand the number of ports. And the USB devices, conventionally all of them, they work as slaves. They cannot initiate any operations, they can only respond to operations that are initiated by the host. Okay. So, there are some registers inside the USB device that can identify what kind of device it is and what kind of drivers it require and so on. So, these devices can work only when the corresponding set of software drivers are there and are installed in the host system. Okay. This is a requirement. So, pictorially, the host system and the USB device, the connection is like this. You see, in the host system you have the USB host controller, that is the connector, and in the software part you have the USB system software, and the highest level you have the client software. And on the other side, they interact with the USB bus interface, because the host controller directly connects to the USB bus interface by a cable. And these are virtual connections. USB system software interacts with USB logical device, and client software interacts with the USB device function, whatever it is. So, the client software determines what transactions are required with the device, what data is to be transferred. Scheduling and configuration of data transfer is completed in USB system software level. This is USB system software level. So, all data transfer gets completed here logically. So, when and how often data is to be transferred, that is decided there. And at the lowest level USB host controller, data transfers are composed and regulated. So, exactly at the low level. So, how are data to appear at the functional device, like the voltages, encoding, everything, and how does system keep track of data sent and received. So, those low level functionalities, they are handled by the lowest level. So, talking about the future of USB, well, you might have seen a third kind of USB plug which is available on the MacBook Air, the recent versions which are there. They have come up with a new USB port called type C port. Now, type C port looks a little circular, they are symmetrical. So, the plug that we are putting in, you can reverse it also and put in without any problem. So, the direction is not important. You can put the plug in any way you want. This is the type C plug. So, they are about the same size. This is a type C plug, you can see a small version of that. Same size as micro connector. They are reversible, as I said, you can put it in any direction you want. and they can deliver pretty high powers. You can see 20 volts and 5 amperes, so it comes to 100 watts. So you can use these ports as your charging points also. You can connect these ports to a charger for charging laptops and phones as well. Now, Thunderbolt is a standard which is also very specific to the Apple systems. Thunderbolt 3 port, they also uses the same kind of USB-C connectors, where the speed can go up to 40 gigabits per second. So, you see in the future you have the same kind of USB ports with smaller feature factors coming up with higher and higher speeds. So, almost any kind of application that demands high speed communication, they can be handled by this kind of interfaces. So, with this we come to the end of this lecture, where we talked about various bus standards, and one of the very important bus standard which is there with us today, the USB. Thank you.